Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Ted. I appreciate the introduction. I mostly appreciate you not reading my bio, which gets longer. And people think that's a feature of being very distinguished. I think it's a feature of being very old every time it gets read. I'm really delighted to be here this morning talking about the broad range of hemispheric issues. I'm delighted to be back at Brookings, and I'm thrilled to be working with Ted again. We have worked together on and off on things hemispheric. Bienvenida, embajadores. I'm glad to see some of my colleagues from the region here. We've been working together steadily on things preparing for the summit. But I must say, most of all, I am happy to be here with the Godfather, who over the last number of years preparing for summits and birthing the first one, has consistently made offers that people could not refuse in preparing for summits for presidents, and really has brought us to a moment when summitry itself has evolved and summits have evolved in this hemisphere to one that I think will be quite remarkable in many ways and will produce things that don't always make the headlines. And I think that in some ways has always been the news out of a summit. And I think I want to start by pointing out that three very smart people, one of them the Godfather, Richard Feinberg, and Harold Trinkunas and Emily Miller, have really written this fantastic paper about the region. A couple of years ago, I wrote a piece for America's Quarterly, which was kind of about the idea that Latin America and the Caribbean has changed. And it was sort of on the idea that it's not your father's Western Hemisphere, right? 10 things you don't know about Latin America and the Caribbean. And like most policymakers, it was very compact, it was short, it was kind of punchy, and it had no data to back it up, right? But it was based on the idea that a lot of old think and old sort of myths about this region persist when it has moved beyond many of those old impressions and it has become a region of capable and equal partners. What this piece that they have done, wonderfully titled, Better Than You Think, Reframing Inter-American Relations, and I've already told Harold and Richard that I will be shamelessly utilizing that phrase, Better Than You Think, and many of the substantive parts of the piece. What this piece argues is just that idea that there is a lot you don't know about what's happened in this hemisphere and how well it has gone for U.S. policy, and the maturity of those relationships is really quite developed, but it does so with all of the data to back it up. And that, for me, is extraordinary. So I thank you for that contribution to the debate and the support for the notion that President Obama brought to Trinidad in 2009 to the Fifth Summit of the Americas, where he outlined a desire to forge equal partnerships in this hemisphere built on common values and common interests. That we won't always agree on everything, which is precisely what this paper says, but that we agree on so many things that are in our mutual interest that we can have mature 21st century relations. I think this summit in Panama will showcase a lot of very important issues that deliver on that promise of equal partnerships, in particular what he promised in 2009, which was an updated architecture for cooperation and partnership based on shared responsibility, truly shared responsibility by the United States and by our partners. One of the most important things, I think, and I'll talk about this a little bit throughout the substantive portions of our priorities at the summit, one of the most important things in that new architecture as seen in the summit developed since 2009. We saw it in 2012 in Cartagena in Colombia, and is the CEO dialogue that you will see, which is going to look in some ways very much like what Colombia did in Cartagena, but the preparations for it do not look the same. Because what has developed, which is exactly what we hoped for, is the America's Business Dialogue and a permanent forum for the private sector to be engaged with leaders in bringing to government their priorities, the way they see the private sector and the economies working, and a way for leaders to interact with the private sector in a more permanent manner between summits and at summits. So that has really developed into something that will be a more constant dialogue along the lines of APEC, which is what we had intended. At this summit, we want to take that next step in another non-governmental area, which is in the civil society area, and try and develop an institutional mechanism for civil society to have that permanent dialogue. Being here with all of you today is part of the dialogue with civil society. Each country should be having that dialogue. We will have the civil society dialogue taking place in the various fora at the summit, but that also needs to take place on a more or less constant basis between summits. And in some ways, by definition, civil society is disorganized. It is not centralized. But it has to figure out a way to have a mechanism that keeps it in, that keeps it connected and that keeps it more or less interacting with leaders in between summits. And so I think some kind of a mechanism for civil society to continue to interact with governments in between summits will also be a, would be a huge benefit coming out of this summit. Our own priorities for this summit really fall into four categories that are part of the basic priorities in the hemisphere that we have. And they are democracy and human rights, global competitiveness, social development, and energy and climate change. They fit very well within both Panama's theme selected for the summit, which was prosperity with equity, and they fit very well within the eight sub-themes that were developed for the summit. Let me go through them very briefly, and then obviously we're going to have a good conversation. On democracy and human rights, there's been a great deal discussed about some backsliding, some concerns, some angst, I would say, about whether we are stepping up on democracy and human rights throughout the hemisphere. But in many ways, I think this summit must confront that issue, both in its positives and in some of its negatives. This is, of course, the first summit that will have all 35. That in itself is momentous, but has to be followed up by a robust conversation among leaders and with civil society groups who are there. The president has committed to being at having a conversation with the Hemispheric Forum on Civil Society because he thinks that is critical, that leaders be held accountable by their civil societies, including, obviously, the civil society participants from the United States, as we interact with our own stakeholders all the time to try and be held accountable and to be transparent. There are four side events, as you know, to the summit. They are on youth, education, the CEO summit, and this civil society summit. They are feedback loops. They are ways that leaders are held accountable by various fora of citizens outside of government. And unless we have that, then we're living in our own echo chamber, frankly, of leaders without getting the input we need from our citizens. We also applaud the governments around the hemisphere that have supported that more robust civil society role. I would say that obviously there's been a lot of attention focused on two particular issues in the democracy and human rights area. They are Cuba and Venezuela. Cuba obviously being at the summit for the first time is going to steal a lot of attention. I think the president's policy change in December gave a huge amount of lift to the issue of engagement on Cuba. It was obviously something we felt was long overdue and takes a huge irritant out of our policy in Latin America and the Caribbean, something that we will continue to move forward on in the coming months and years, because full normalization will take years. I would argue that there are very real challenges on democracy in Venezuela that the entire hemisphere needs to be concerned about, not just UNASUR, not just the neighbors of Venezuela, and certainly not just the United States. It never has been and won't be a bilateral issue. It's a hemispheric issue, but most of all, it's a Venezuelan issue for Venezuelans to resolve. I think that the issue of sanctions on seven individuals, frankly, has been blown way out of proportion, and language, infelicitous language, in an executive order that is standard, and in fact just came out 2 days ago in another executive order on cybersecurity. But I would also note that UNASUR, in the middle of March, when they put out a declaration on the sanctions issue, put out two declarations, which almost no one in the media picked up on. Those declarations were on the sanctions and unilateral actions perceived and rejected by UNASUR. They were also on elections and democracy. And that went almost unnoticed by many people. And that was very important, too. And the importance of human rights and the rule of law in Venezuela and moving forward on the elections. So that is a debate that really needs to continue to be had. And we are certainly comfortable having that full debate. On economic growth and competitiveness, there is and will continue to be a direct connection between economic growth and competitiveness and the democracy, human rights, accountability issues that I began with. If you don't have institutions of governance that are transparent, that are responding to the needs of citizenry, that present justice systems that are equal, accessible to all, and provide a level playing field, then your own economic growth is going to be stymied as well, and expansion of opportunity is going to be retarded. So there is a direct connection between those things. They cannot be hived off and separated. We will focus in this summit, because macroeconomic numbers, especially during a commodity boom, have been okay on the whole. And certainly this hemisphere has gone through the macroeconomic reforms that many other countries are struggling with around the world. We will focus a lot of our attention on small business, generating huge numbers of jobs, and not necessarily always getting the support that they need, support in credit, access to credit, support in job training. We know that the Small Business Network of the Americas has now fostered huge numbers of job creation in the hemisphere. There are over 4,000 small business development centers that have been created since we launched these partnerships between small business development centers in the U.S. and small business development centers in the countries of Latin America and the Caribbean. In Colombia alone, these efforts created nearly 6,000 jobs and increased some businesses' sales over 50%. Even in the United States, under 2% of small businesses export. But the minute you can connect small businesses to markets elsewhere, even if those are neighbors next door, you can hugely raise their capabilities while remaining, obviously, small and medium-sized enterprises. And I've already talked about the America's Business Dialogue, which I think is going to be essential as a continuing forum for movement on the economic sector. But I also think that we need to continue to press in the economic sector and among our business leaders for attention to equity issues and the inequality issues, access to justice and judicial reform, which are as important for them as investors and business people as they are for those who are shut out of the justice system because of resources or socioeconomic reasons. On social development, that's my segue into that one, and the issue of inclusion, I think this is one of the most important issues facing the region right now. We know it is still the most unequal region in the world. There are terrific statistics in Richard and Emily and Harold's paper about the way in which inequality has been reduced in the 2000s, and that has been impressive, but it's from high levels of inequality and more needs to be done. the numbers that we've seen of people moving into the middle class in this hemisphere are staggering. They are impressive. Conditional cash transfer programs and other things have worked remarkably well. Those have to be sustained, and that in itself is difficult, especially with commodity prices softening, so we need diversification of economies, obviously. But also we need to remember how many people were left out of that process, whether it's because of geography, whether it's because they're in vulnerable population groups, indigenous groups, Afro-Latinos, women. That push to get that those benefits out to more people has to be doubled, has to be made more real. And that brings us to the issue of education, where we know there is a huge deficit in the region. The region's higher education institutions remain not up to the challenge of the 21st century, and many leaders recognize this. So we will continue to push where we can with the 100,000 Strong in the Americas program, which has now awarded 38 innovation grants to 110 higher education institutions in 12 countries. Steve Vetter's here, and I'm proud that he's continuing to work with us on this and really moving ahead with a lot of private sector partnerships in a lot of countries, but we need to do even more. At partnering, we know that wholesale connections, because what we're doing is connecting institutions to institutions. We're not funding individual scholarships. We know that connecting universities and colleges to universities and colleges will raise the number of students who go on these exchanges faster than funding individual scholarships. We've seen the numbers of students rising over the last couple of years by 12 to 13% in each direction already. We have to get that up even higher. We know that these models work, and they work not just at the Harvard, Yale, and Stanford. In fact, it's much more important that we focus on community colleges in the United States and a growing number of countries that are looking at this model for their own use. Technical colleges, politécnicos in Mexico, and other things that are training students for 21st century jobs that aren't, and I'm a deeply committed social science person and humanities person, but that aren't necessarily going to make them unemployable with an anthropology degree or a degree in one of the sciences, social sciences, that they may not be able to use. An example would be a woman named Myra from a small community in Honduras who obtained a degree in business management from a community college in Iowa through SEED, S-E-E-D, which is the Scholarships for Education and Economic Development, where we're going to be putting $50 million for 1,300 students. Myra established, when she went back to Honduras, the Catracha Coffee Company, which helped a group of traditional small coffee farmers export to the United States, tripling their profits. Catracha returned more than $30,000 to farmers through its profit sharing and social welfare program, which is really, really powerful. The last thing I want to talk about is energy and the environment, because the other impediment that we know keeps areas of this hemisphere from realizing their full potential is high cost of energy in some places. And what we are looking at in this hemisphere on the other side of the issue on climate change is huge energy resources to be exploited, enormous, enormous wealth in the energy sector. But the possibility of doing it responsibly and sustainably as we face climate change crises around the globe, especially when we look at increasing weather events in Central America that can be disastrous, an obvious concern in the Caribbean and to island states. More than 31 million citizens in this hemisphere lack affordable energy, and we expect electricity demand in this region to double over the next decade, which is why we launched the Energy and Climate Partnership of the Americas and Connecting the Americas 2022 to promote renewable energy, efficiency, cleaner fossil fuels, resilient infrastructure, and interconnection. There are a number of examples I could give you on this, but we are seeing much greater connectivity among countries. CEPAC in Central America has now completed the connection in 2014 that connected 37 million consumers in Costa Rica, El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, Nicaragua, and Panama. We know that energy costs, electricity rates, energy costs in Central America and the Caribbean are way above what many other countries pay, especially what we pay in the United States, and that is holding back economic progress. Unless we can encourage connectivity and the ability to move energy from the places in the hemisphere that have it and are developing it to places in the hemisphere that will never be self-sustaining on energy, at least not in the short term, and bring those energy costs down, we will never be able to overcome cycles of economic difficulty, and with it, cycles of migration, poverty, and violence, such as we see in Central America and the Caribbean, until we tackle those energy prices and those structural problems. So I think in all of those areas, we have initiatives that we'll be bringing to the summit, ways to tackle pragmatic problems that, frankly, aren't based on ideology, and that we're willing to engage on with every country in the hemisphere, any country that wants to partner with us, because they're in all of our interests. And that's the way the partnerships should be based, on mutual interests, because that's the way most countries should structure their foreign policy, not on ideology, but on mutual interests, because that's what makes them durable. So let me stop there. I think it's going to be a very good Summit of the Americas, and I look forward to the conversation. Thank you very much.